الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، هو رب العالمين، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، إمام المتقين ورسول رب العالمين، الذي بعث إلى الأحمر والأسود، والذي تركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سلك طريقهم وسار على نهجهم ودعا بدعوتهم إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم. أما بعد، my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it is absolutely important that we remind each other constantly about being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Arabic language, the term used is taqwallahi. Some say it is the fear of Allah. The truth is, fear of Allah is a part of it. But we do deeds because of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear the punishment that Allah has prepared. But when we say to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes the English language is not qualified to translate the Arabic language in an appropriate way, because the term fear, as you and I know, has an element within the heart that is negative, whereas taqwa has only positive elements. When I fulfill salah, it is not that I'm scared of Allah, but it is that I love Allah and Allah loves me. But I am scared of the punishment that Allah has prepared. This is what it is. This is why Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahmatullahi alayhi, in his explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, the book known as Fathul Bari, he says, taqwa Allahi. Taqwa means, and this is his interpretation of it, أن تجعل بينك وبين عذاب الله وقايا بامتثال أوامره واجتناب نواهيه. It is to create a barrier between you and the punishment of Allah. Wiqaya. Wiqaya means a barrier. To create a barrier between you and the punishment of Allah by obeying the instructions and staying away from prohibitions. So my brothers and sisters, every Friday when the Imam stands up, he gets up and he says, Ittaqullaha ibadallah. Am I right? He reads the verses, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ittaqullaha. Or he says, Ittaqullah, somewhere in his talk. I want you to understand and realize today that that term taqwa means to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of your love for Him and out of your fear of the punishment that He has prepared. May Allah make it easy for us. Today I want to take you through a beautiful journey, a beautiful journey. We are Muslimin, we are fortunate. The term Islam refers to two things. It refers to al-istislamu lillahi, to surrender to the law of Allah, to surrender to Allah. So when we say Islam, some say it means submission. Yes, it includes the term or the meaning submission in it. Some would say Islam means peace, which is true from salam. Salam means peace. When I greet you, assalamu alaykum, I mean may peace be upon you. It's a beautiful prayer. One of the best greetings on earth, in fact, the best greeting, is to greet with the greeting of peace. When I say assalamu alaikum, guess what I'm doing? I am praying for you. I am telling you, may peace be on you. And may the blessings of Allah be on you. May the mercy of Allah be on you. Wow, what a beautiful prayer. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Ala adullukum ala amrin idha fa'altumuhu tahababtum. Should I not show you that thing? If you were to do it, it would spread love between you. Spread the salam amongst yourselves. greet the people and understand what is the meaning of the greeting and understand what it entails from you, what it requires from you, if you were to say it genuinely. If I genuinely say Assalamu alaikum, it means I promise you I won't harm you. I want you to live in peace. I want you to be in harmony. I want the blessings of Allah to come upon you. I want the mercy of Allah to be for you. And the person says, Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I pray the same for you. What a beautiful greeting. Now my brothers and sisters, once we submit to Allah, we will achieve the peace. But sometimes we as Muslimin are weak. Guess why we are weak? We are weak because our link with Allah is weak. It is contaminated by all the advertisements we see around us that are advertising everything besides the hereafter. Have you ever seen a single advert saying, you are going to go to the hereafter, prepare for it. Who wants a palace in the hereafter? Please read Salah. Have you seen an advert on the streets like that? No. They only advertise mobile phones, motor vehicles, anything that is to do with materialistic items which you can use for a short space of time. That is the nature of this world. It is short. But the true adverts happen. Hayya ala salah. Come to salah. Hayya ala falah. Come to success, the true success. You and I today, our brains are already conned by the world, thinking that true success is when I'm a millionaire. If you were to ask a young man, what is success? He will tell you, when I earn my first million, I am successful. But if you ask a person who knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is success? He will say, the day I receive my hand, on my right hand, the book of deeds, then I have succeeded. So I want to ask you, what do you want? Some might find it difficult to answer. Some might say, I want the hereafter. But in their heart, they know I also want to be a millionaire. Am I right? We say, I want Jannatul Firdaus. But in your heart, you want the latest phone. I want Jannatul Firdaus. But in your heart, you want that car which I saw the other uncle driving. Wow! So Allah says, I know this about you. I created you. I made you. I know what you want. Therefore, I will teach you how to pray and call out. Allah says, Subhanallah. Let's listen to this verse of Surah Al-Baqarah. It's amazing. You must have heard it many times. You say it many times. But today you may understand the value of it. I've explained to you this introduction. Allah says, فَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَمَا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. There are some people whom when they call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say, oh Allah, give us in this world, give us in this world. And they forget about making dua for the hereafter. So Allah says they have no naseeb, they have no portion, they have no khalaq, they have nothing, no fraction of the hereafter. They get in the dunya, in this world, and in the hereafter they have lost. So Allah says, وَمِنْهُمْ. But from among the people, they are the righteous. They are those who know the balance. They are those who know we want Jannah, but we have to live in this world. So we also want a decent life. So Allah says, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, from among the people are those who say, oh Allah, give us goodness in the hereafter. We also need the million. Oh Allah, we also need goodness in the in this world. But in this world, we also need the goodness. But oh Allah, give us goodness in the hereafter as well. Subhanallah. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. Listen carefully to that dua. It is divided into three portions. The first part is praying for this worldly life. Oh Allah, give us a decent life. My brothers and sisters, a decent life means a life that comes with contentment. It is not necessarily in figures. Remember this. And the evidence of it is there are wealthy people who cannot sleep. There are wealthy people who are not happy. If wealth brought you happiness, they would have been the happiest. But there are people who are wealthy who are depressed. There are people who have so much, but they don't have a life. They are so sad, they cannot sleep. They cannot walk out. They cannot do much. They cannot interact with people. They lead a lonely life, but they have all the wealth in the world. Yes, there are some who have wealth and contentment. That is the top rank that you can have. When Allah blesses you, Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, rahmatullahi alayh, a great man, he had wealth and he also had goodness, contentment, happiness. He was also involved in activity to spread the deen in a beautiful way. So those are the winners. These are the people who have goodness both ways. I'm not saying it's bad to be wealthy, but I'm saying if you are wealthy and you don't have contentment and you don't have a link with Allah, then that wealth is actually destructive, not constructive. Remember that. But if a person has wealth and they are spending it in the right cause, they are more humble. They are the ones who reach out to everyone else. MashaAllah, we are happy. This dua, the first part of it is Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana. Oh Allah, give us goodness in this world. The second part of it, oh Allah, give us goodness in the hereafter. The third part of it, oh Allah, save us from the painful punishment of the fire. Azab an-nar, the punishment of the fire. It means if we were to divide this dua into three, one third is connected to this world and two thirds are connected to the hereafter. Do you see the fraction? Do you see the proportion? The effort we make should not be such that I fulfill for this world whole day and only my salah I quickly dart through to the masjid or to this place and I fulfill the prayer because I have to. That shouldn't be my only connection with my deen. Your paradise will not only be achieved through your prayer. Prayer is a vital part of it without a denial. It is a pillar of Islam without a denial. But it is not the only thing that Islam teaches. People think, I'm a Muslim. Do you pray 5 times a day? Yes. Then you are a good Muslim. That is not necessarily true. There are people who pray 5 times a day, but they are included in a hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Atadruna man al-muflis?" Do you know who is the bankrupt one? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they answered, a bankrupt one is the one who has no money, no dirham, no dinar, no gold, no silver, no coins, no nothing, no fulus, as we would say. He says, no, that's not what we're talking about. A bankrupt person is a person who comes on the day of judgment and he has a lot of salah. What does he have? A lot of salah. He has a lot of zakah. He has a lot of charitable deeds. He has fulfilled so much. But يَأْتِي وَقَدْ قَذَفَ هَذَا وَأَكَلَ مَالَ هَذَا. He came, he had usurped the rights of this one. He has slandered that one. He has eaten the wealth of this one. He has cheated that one. He has deceived this one. What happens? So his deeds go as a payment for the evil he did against others. Yet he thought he was in the first saf 5 times a day. So he is set and paradise is his. So we go home. We are the ones who go home after salah in the first saf with jama'ah, with the first takbir, and we swear the wife. We speak evil to the children. We have no time for our family members. What type of Muslim is that? You have misunderstood. Islam is not only the prayer. Yet the prayer is indeed a part of it. Understand this. What makes you a good Muslim is the package. The whole package. That's what it is. Islam is a way of life. That's what it is. Islam is not only in the house of Allah, in the masjid. When you come to Ramadan, you become a very good man, a very good woman. As soon as Ramadan is over, it's like you follow a different religion altogether. Why? Islam is a package. My brothers and sisters, the whole life needs to change. Improve your condition. When you are walking on the street, people must be able to see this man is a diamond. He is an ambassador of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Today, when you have diplomatic vehicles around you, you automatically know that this means this person is representing his or her nation. Am I right? What you would realize and understand is that person will never do something against what
that country stands for. Am I right? Otherwise, there would not be an ambassador. There would not be a diplomat. We are all ambassadors of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Are you really and truly a man or a woman who follows his path and his way? If that was the case, you would develop softness in your heart. You would develop kindness in your heart. You would develop the love of one another in your heart. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ It is only by the mercy of Allah that you are lenient towards them. Towards whom? Towards those who are with you, around you, the companions, etc., etc. Allah says, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ If you were hard-hearted, if you were harsh and hard-hearted, they would have dispersed from around you. This shows that anyone whose nature is hard-hearted and they are harsh, people don't want to associate with them. We are like that, my brothers and sisters, in our homes. With our wives, with our husbands, with our children and parents and brothers and sisters. Forget about the rest of humanity. We need to change this. Go today and improve your condition at home. Please, I beg you. Because we want to solve the whole ummah's problems. But at home, I'm not ready to forgive my brother because I have a problem worth $1,000 with him. It's over. That's it. My brother, be the bigger one. Never mind. Rise above it, forgive, forget, continue. Your life will be more valuable than $1,000,000. For one, you are fighting, that is your blood. Come on, stop it. Don't allow that. We, many of us today, we don't spend time with our children. We don't even have a meal with them. And we say, I'm a Muslim, I'm a good Muslim, I read 5 salah a day. Allah blessed you with those children. Go and ask those who don't have children. May Allah bless them with children. Go and ask them. And we have the kids, but we are never there for them. We don't even look at them. We don't even talk to them. We don't show an interest in their life. We don't smile at them. We don't tell them, I love you. And I'm a good Muslim. Why? Because I look like a Muslim. I wear my jilbab. I wear everything. And I read salah in the first saf. And in Ramadan, I give lots of money. Keep your money, do your thing to your own. That's what your children must be thinking. Why? Change. Islam is a beautiful religion. Many of us, the non-Muslims, look at us. They see us as hypocrites. They see us as people who don't practice Islam. A lot of it is to do with ignorance. I tell you, the day that things will change is the day when you fulfill salah because you consider it an honor to fulfill salah rather than fulfilling salah because you think it's just a duty and a responsibility. I need to get done with it. Let me explain what I mean. What I mean is, we all fulfill salah, I hope, 5 times a day. We all fulfill salah, I hope, inshallah, 5 times a day. Those who are weak, may Allah make you strong. Remember, without your effort, you are not going to get anywhere. So don't just say, oh Allah, make me strong for salah. Then when you have to set your clock in the morning, it's already set for 7 o'clock. What type of help do you want? You say, oh Allah, give me money. But you are just sitting down there waiting. For what? Go and work and see how much Allah will give you. You need to make an effort. Allah says, I gave you hands, I gave you energy, I gave you your brain, I gave you so much. You go, make the effort, the rest we will do. Don't worry. So when you say, oh Allah, help me to get up for salah, set your clock for 4:30. Set your clock for 4:30. And then you see, when it rings, tell yourself, I made a dua to Allah. Allah got me up. Alhamdulillah, let me not sit back and press snooze. You know, there is a snooze button on your phone. When you snooze, you lose. You know that. When you snooze, you lose. No. When I get up for salah and I no longer get up because I think it's a burden or because I think I have to get up. I am getting up now because I want to get up. There is a very big difference between the two. If you came for Jumu'ah because you have to come for Jumu'ah, there is one level higher than that. When you come to Jumu'ah because you want to come to Jumu'ah. There is a very big difference between the two. I am reading Salah because I want to. I want to. I love Allah. I want to fulfill my obligations. But when I'm reading Salah because I have to, there's a difference. One is I'm doing it because if I had an option, I would not do it. That's what it means. If you had an option not to read salah, would you not read salah? If salah was voluntary, would you read it? The answer in a lot of cases, may Allah forgive me too. Perhaps people might say, if it was not necessary, I wouldn't be doing it. Okay? The day when you say, you know what, I am doing it is an honor. As an honor for me, that is the day that you know you are closer to Allah than the previous day. That is what I want to tell you today. That taqwallahi, this issue of being conscious of Allah, it develops into love of Allah. When you love Allah, you want to do things for Him. Not that you have to do it. Many of us, we give zakah. What is the percentage of zakah, by the way? What is the percentage of zakah that we give of our wealth? 2.5%. Everyone knows it off by heart. What is 2.5%? It is small, small, smaller than most other churches and religions ever. Those are the Muslims. Do you know that? The figure is the smallest. Do you know that? But when we calculate, we don't want to give $1 more. The day your sadaqah, which is voluntary, becomes more than your zakah, is the day you really and truly love Allah. When I say, Ya Allah, 2.5% is farad. It's from me to you. In fact, it is yours which you bestowed upon me. For every $100 Allah gives you, it is actually $97.5. $2.5 are changed. They belong to Allah. It's not yours. It was never yours. All you have to do is take it out of your wealth and give it back. It's like a man gives you $100 and the product costed $97.5. That $2.5, who does it belong to? No matter how rich that man is, you have to take it out of the till and give it to him. Otherwise, you are a cheat. So when you give Allah what belonged to Him, that is Allah's. That was always His. But the big deal is when you say, listen, you know what? Ya Allah, 2.5 is yours. I'm giving another 10% from me for your sake because I love you. Allahu Akbar. Is that wealth going to deplete? Ma naqasa malun min sadaqa. Money has never depleted due to a charity. Allah says it's impossible. Do you know why? Because when I give an orphan money, if I make it regular that I'm going to give this orphan or the orphanage or this school or this good institute, etc., etc., some money every single month, you know what happens? Allah has written sustenance for them. Okay? So it's coming through me, which means Allah will give it to me first and then it will get to those people. For as long as I'm giving them, Allah will continue to give me because it has to go to them. When I stop, Allah says, okay, no problem. We are going to give more, but through another person. Allahu Akbar. Why? Why don't we look at it as, wallahi, it's an honor. We can spend, I'm not joking, we can spend so many dollars on data bundles for our phone. Am I right? We can spend dollars when it comes to a restaurant and food and petrol and a car. We don't even think we will go. In one evening, we have already blown a huge amount. But when it comes to sadaqat, we just hold back. We just hold back. Do you know in some masajid on a Friday, some parts of the world, so there are people who walk around the aisles, down the aisles, because they need to collect even to run the masajid, subhanallah. So they walk down the aisles. What people do? They give. Some people don't give. And sometimes, you know, shaitan comes to us and makes us think that if I don't give, perhaps people will look at me and they will think, what a rich man, and he's not giving anything. So there was one wealthy guy and he decided, let me put $2 note or $1 note. You know, I will just put it in my pocket and I will give it. I will give this note. So as the people came round, he took out his money from the back pocket and he picked out that little dirty dollar and he closed it and he put it with his hands closed into the little tin, into the bucket. And as he put it in, he removed his hand. No one knows how much you put in. My brother, it's up to you. Some people maybe, they put an empty hand in and leave it because no one knows what went in. So he put his hand and he came out. In the meantime, the brother at the back, he had a $100 bill. He tapped the same person's shoulder, gave him the $100. So that man took the $100 and he thought, that one wants to give $100 to put into the bucket. So he took the $100 and he put it into the bucket. And he continued, that bucket continued. So this man looked at him later on. He said, brother, mashallah, jazakallah khair, thank you. He said, no, you dropped the $100 from your pocket, so I gave you. What? I thought you were giving $100 for the bucket. He says, no, when you took out the money from your back pocket, the 100 dropped, so I gave you. Now he's asking a question, can I change my intention to say, oh Allah, it's a sadaqah. Oh Allah, it's a sadaqah. Why do we have to wait for that to happen? Give the money for the sake of Allah. Read your salah for the sake of Allah. But more importantly, my brothers and sisters, protect those acts of worship. I was mentioning this hadith. The hadith about protecting your deeds. Okay? So, if you have fulfilled your salah, look after it. Don't give it to someone else. How do you give it to someone? Backbiting, cheating, deceiving, stealing, oppressing, abusing. Verbal abuse. You swear someone, you are rough with your spouse, she will be in Jannah before you. And in Jannah, when... May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. When she is asked whether she wants to see you or not, I don't know what the response will be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Obviously, this is just with our own minds. What lies in Jannah is far higher than that, inshallah. So, when we fulfill salah, be mindful. Allah says, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Whoever comes with a good deed, that deed shall be multiplied by tenfold. Have you ever asked yourself, why didn't Allah say, مَنْ عَمِلَ حَسَنَةً فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Whoever does a good deed, it will be multiplied. Allah didn't say that. Allah did not say whoever does a good deed. Allah says whoever comes with a good deed. Man ja'a bil hasana. Whoever comes with the good deed. To do the deed is easy. But to protect the deed is 10 times more difficult. You deserve 10 times greater reward for protecting it on the day of judgment. When you come, if that deed is still there, it's still intact, you deserve 10 times reward. So the point I'm raising today, develop your taqwa, develop your consciousness of Allah, learn to love Allah, and to get close to Allah, you will have to fulfill the rights of the other creatures of the same Allah. Who created everyone else? Allah. He's the one who created you. What makes you think you have the right and superiority over them in a way that you can discard their rights? Everyone has rights over you, and you have rights over them. Everyone. They have different types of rights. A Muslim has a right, a neighbor has another right, a relative has another right, a non-Muslim has a certain type of a right too. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us, may Allah help us. My brothers and sisters, remember, develop yourself. Do deeds because you love Allah. Yes, they are farad. Yes, we know what is compulsory. We know it's compulsory. At the beginning, you will do it because it's compulsory. It might even be considered a burden to some people. But you are doing it because it's compulsory. There will come a time, and there must come a time, when you are doing it because you consider it an honor. I want to end this morning's first khutbah by making mention of a story. I have met some people in my life who have taught me a big lesson. I have met absolutely influential people, and I have met extremely wealthy people who will not miss salah in the masjid. I have met a man who will not miss adhan in the masjid. What that means is, he will try his best that before the adhan starts, he's already sitting in the house of Allah. Before the call, we don't have to do that, but it's his love. It's his love for Allah. He will do it because he loves Allah. He wants. That is how Allah gets close to you. Imagine if you say, oh Allah, I will be there before, considering it an honor. Instead of waiting for the caller to call, I'm there before the caller. Subhanallah, look at the love. If the influential can do this, if the wealthy can do this, if those who have everything in the world can do it, who are we? Who are we? We are nothing. We need Allah desperately, my brothers and sisters. Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you, and He will always help you for as long as you are helping one another. كَانَ اللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.